Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Why We Resist God. And it is part of the Relationship with God series. It was presented in Bathurst, New South Wales, Australia, on the 17th of June, 2012.
Okay. Well, today
I will talk mostly, it'll basically be a question and answer session today. But what I wanted to do today with you is just raise an issue that I feel comes up from yesterday's discussion first, and then we can perhaps have some question and answers about it. So you've got the mic again, have you, Alex? Yeah. So for those of you, when you share, if you could just wait for the mic. Yesterday, the discussion we had yesterday was the relationship with God, the eternal benefits discussion. And I don't know about you, but I found many of you in the audience quite resistive to the discussion about God. And what I wanted to do today was talk to you about why mankind is so resistive to discussions about God. And we can have a bit of a discussion about that particular problem. Can I perhaps firstly give you a bit of history about mankind's existence and why this resistance towards God began, and then what happened with regard to the development of religions that caused mankind to have such a negative viewpoint of God? When God created the first human couple, and obviously, when I say created them, he created the bodies in which they existed. So he created the first couple's bodies. So both of the bodies, the spirit physical body and the spirit bodies, were created by God directly. And then the soul, of course, was already created by God, and the soul, the first human couple, incarnated. They don't have, when you talk to them, they don't have a memory of being young, like babies. They just incarnated and began their experience in an adult-looking body. And as a result of that, they don't really have the same experience that many of us have had, in the sense that we were born and we slowly absorbed things through our environment. They still absorb things through their environment, but they weren't born in the same manner that we were born. However, those first human pair decided before they even had children of their own that they didn't want to have a relationship with God. Well, and to be accurate, it's not probably what they decided. What they decided to, in an accurate statement of what they decided that they wanted to be the same as God. So they wanted to have an elevated condition that was exactly the same as God's condition without having to do anything for it. They felt that they had enough intelligence, that they had enough knowledge that God had given them through a process over years that God had been spending time with them, and that eventually they felt that they should be able to be God themselves, and that they didn't need God making rules for them, they didn't need God to determine things for them. And so what they did is they chose rebellion and self-reliance. And in this process of choosing rebellion and self-reliance, they ended up in this state where they couldn't connect to God anymore, because they'd chosen to reject God. And in this state of rebellion and self-reliance, they began immediately to degrade in their condition of love. So they started to degrade and go in a negative direction when it came to their condition of love. Because to make that decision, they didn't understand enough about love already to even make that decision. So God allowed them, of course, to go ahead with that rebellion and that self-reliance. God allows us to do anything we choose with our will. Joy?
AJ, when they...
Just wait for the mic to come up. Yep,
fine. When they appeared, what condition were they in to start with?
Well, you would classify it as a six-sphere condition now. So They were perfect. They were perfectly made, and their soul was free of all emotional injuries. So they didn't make this choice out of an emotional injury. They made the choice based on a desire rather than an emotional injury. Does that make sense? So that also indicates that a six-sphere individual, a person who's in the sixth sphere, can make a choice out of harmony with love. So it's not impossible to make a choice out of harmony with love even when you've become perfected. And that's something that most people don't understand. But you can use your will in any direction. So you can always choose to use your will in a different direction than you've used it 10 minutes ago. And if you think about the course of an average day for most of us, we use our will sometimes positively or lovingly and other times very negatively, even in the course of one day. You know, sometimes we're in a rageful place or angry with someone or wanting to hurt somebody, and then we go into this feeling of sorrow about that and repentance about that and feel sad that we've done that, and then something else comes up, and before we know it we're back into another angry place or something like that, and where we're wanting to hurt somebody or yell at somebody or so forth. And in the course of an average day, even the feelings in us do that. Even if we don't verbalise those feelings, oftentimes we have those feelings. It's a little different here, though, of course, because they don't have the injuries, or they didn't have the injuries, the original couple didn't have the emotional injuries that would have dictated to them to do these kind of things. They made an active choice. It was a choice to be God, basically. In that process, they went into rebellion and self-reliance. They no longer wanted to hear from God about love, and they no longer wanted to learn about love from God. And as a result of that, they had to rely on their own interpretations. And as they then had children after that point, they then imposed exactly the same emotional injuries upon their children, and their children very rapidly degraded in condition as a result of the walking away from God. Now, what happened there, though, is that there was this idea of rebellion. So that if we look at the emotional injuries that are on the planet right now with regard to God, the number one emotional injury is rebellion. We don't like law. We don't like God telling us what God's laws are. We want to go through the process of discovering it all ourselves. You look, even at a little tiny child has this emotion most of the time. If you think back to when you were bringing up your children, by the time the child is 2 years of age, and you know, they go through the terrible twos, as the saying goes, the terrible twos are often this spirit of rebellion already being imposed upon its environment that is already present within the child, because it's an emotional injury we've carried down for millennia, thousands of years. The second emotional injury that got established there and then was also this emotional injury of self-reliance. In other words, feeling that the only person that I can rely on is myself. I can't really rely on a partner because they might leave me, they might cheat on me, they might do something like that, so I can't rely on a partner. I can't rely on my friends because sometimes my friends have different agendas than what I have, and so therefore I can't really rely on them. And in the end, most people finish up having a feeling inside of them that they really, the only person they can really rely on is themselves. Now, then what happened was that obviously Ammon and Amman, the first human couple, started having children. So they, through their union, they had children. So let's just draw some of their children and grandchildren, obviously, they had as well. Now, during this phase of children, some of these children passed into the spirit world. Now, in the early times of our existence, it took many hundreds of years for a person to pass. And sometimes there have been records in early history where some people lived almost 1,000 years in terms of time on the earth. But that very, very rapidly also degraded because of the degradation of the soul condition. And very rapidly, we went down to 100 years of life on the earth. And then even after that, it became even worse. And eventually, it went down, the longevity of the average person was around 20 years at some points in human history. So the soul condition had been so degraded by this stage that the average person could only live 20 to 30 years before dying from old age. So that shows you how negative the planet was in that state. These people passed over into the spirit world, and because the general population of the earth at the time was more open to spirit interference, these people began imposing their feelings upon the planet as well. So this caused a rapid degradation on the planet. And as a result of that, many people on earth started believing that these people were God, and these people were in a rage with mankind. They were manipulative, controlling, punishing. They were constantly trying to make things hard for people on the earth. They wanted all of their addictions met, and they tried to connect to people on earth who would allow the connection. And they try to influence people in a very negative direction. As a result, there grew a lot of concepts about God, that God is wrathful, and in fact, the concept about God that grew then was that God was in a rage with mankind, was the concept. And because these spirits acted out in a rageful manners towards the people that were on earth, this concept was reinforced through the belief system. Fourthly, what would happen is that because these people were now in a state where they were actively working against God's loving laws, there was a higher and more powerful law of attraction in a negative direction. And what that meant was that the law of attraction now was bringing them to them individually events which made these people feel like they were being harmed by the law of attraction itself, and therefore being harmed by God. And so what most people started believing was that God wanted to hurt them and that God had to be appeased. God had to be, worshipped and also, appeased in some way. And this is where a lot of the belief systems that, you had, and eventually they started sacrificing their own children to God in order to appease God, to make God's wrath go away, for example. And so there was this whole idea that God was going to punish them. And the only way that that God wouldn't punish them would be that you had to appease God. You had to, you had to make God feel good, and then God wouldn't harm you, is the whole concept. And so eventually what they started doing is sacrificing their own children. Sacrificing of animals was very common. The whole concept grew that, your very first fruits that you received off of any tree or bush or crop all had to be given to God. So you had to burn it or destroy it so that it would appease God. And then, of course, the earth went through cycles as well, cycles of change, major cataclysmic change, similar to what I feel is coming soon upon the earth as well. And these cycles of cataclysmic change also caused these people to believe that that was God's punishment of people on the planet as well. So it started to reinforce these beliefs. And so what they started to feel was that the events that their soul was attracting, instead of seeing it as a direct result of their own unloving behaviour, they started seeing it as God punishing them, and God started looking more and more to them like a cruel, cruel God. Someone who wanted to make their life difficult from the moment they were born, basically. Now, because many people still had a feeling that God existed, they then had to create religious structures that enabled them to safely believe these things about God. And so what they did was they started creating religious structures where they started to feel like God could be justified, and they started actually creating religions surrounding these belief systems that God was like this. And so all through human history and the so-called Christian viewpoint of God, or the so-called Muslim viewpoint of God, or the Hindu viewpoint of God now, many of these viewpoints have been around far longer than those particular religions have ever been established. For literally hundreds of thousands of years, these viewpoints have been around on the planet. And as a result, the the viewpoint of God has been just imposed upon the planet over and over and over and over and over again. On top of that, for most people, they have a lot of emotional injuries towards their parents, right? So if you think about the average person, you've got different emotions that you have towards your dad and different emotions you had towards your mum. And when you look back at your childhood, you can see how your dad treated you and how your mum treated you. Now, if your dad treated you violently, then you would start to also accept that God was going to treat you violently, the masculine part of God. If mum was aloof, then you feel that the feminine part of God was aloof. And you start imposing the emotional belief systems that you've gained in your environment upon God as well. So now, besides having all of these issues with God, about God's nature and all of those kind of things, now we're adding to that a whole group of emotions, which I would call gender-based. Emotional beliefs. Now, when I do a presentation about God, it is the most difficult presentations. They are, for me, still the most difficult presentations to give. Mostly because all of these particular belief systems are in the soul of almost every person on this planet, even if they intellectually believe they don't have those belief systems. And as a result of that, any discussion about God or relationship with God is generally very difficult to conduct with a group of people. And if you think about all of those injuries, what I'm basically saying is that the person we have the most injuries with is God. Right? And then add to that, you've got some crazy nutter who calls himself Jesus talking about this God. Then you've got a whole additional set of injuries to work your way through with regard to that person as well. And so it becomes very, very difficult to actually be open in a discussion about God. In addition, if you examine it, the average person I interact with is either male or female. Is that not right? You're talking on a one-on-one interaction, we're either interacting with another male or a female, in my case. And in your case, it's exactly the same. You're either interacting with a man or a woman. So when you're interacting with a man or a woman, you've at least can dismiss half of the injuries. Do you understand? Because half of the injuries are probably with the male. And if you're interacting with a woman, then you don't have to worry about those particular injuries when you're interacting with that person. You're only going to be involved in the injuries that involve you with the female, if you're interacting with the female. So immediately, with our interactions on the planet, even if no addictions are involved, we've already got half the amount of injuries than we've got with God. Right? Because God is both masculine and feminine, it's a sum total of all of our injuries to both genders that we're dealing with when we're dealing with God. So what we find then is that even in our interaction with individuals, we are far more open than we would be if we were interacting with God. In addition to that, we're often involved in addictive relationships with individuals. So we're often attracted to a person because of what they give us, because of, that we have a nice feeling when we talk to that person, and we don't have a very nice feeling when we talk to that person. So which person are we going to talk to the most? The person who we have a nice feeling with, right? And if that happens to be some kind of addiction that it causes us to be in that attraction and not just a pure state of love that the person is in, then straight away I'm going to feel even more attracted to discussing something with that individual and more open to what they're saying as a result than I would be talking to someone who I'm not very attracted to. Now, if you think about that with God, God does not meet addictions. Remember I said that yesterday. So God doesn't meet any addictions. So any time that we're attracted to an individual because of the addictions they meet in us that causes us to feel an attraction to them, we can't have that relationship with God either. So then there's another set. God does not meet my addictions. Because remember, God wants you to grow. And if you are meeting your addictions, you're not going to grow very rapidly. You're going to be stagnant in your growth. So can you see, a relationship with God now has all of these impediments involved in it in comparison to a relationship with an individual. And so what people started to do on earth was they started to feel like it was totally impossible to have a relationship with God at all. Right? And what they did instead is they started making certain people who they believed were holy into gods while those persons lived on earth. Does that make sense? So persons like Buddha, for example, were made into a god. Because Buddha was a person who, you know, seemed to be outwardly spiritual to the majority of people who surrounded him at the time and seemed to have this connection with God that nobody else seemed to have. And in fact, Buddha himself didn't actually believe in a personal god anyway, which was also very handy for most of the people who were around him at the time. So, and he believed that God was more like an energy system, like the universe itself. And as a result of that, many people came to accept his belief systems. And because his belief systems were more loving than the average belief systems on the planet, they believed that Buddha himself was in a more loving place, which he was. And therefore, they started to follow the man and started to appoint him as God, in place of God. They also did the same with myself in the first century. Because I was at one with God and displayed the characteristics or nature of God in a pure place when I was at one with God, they then started to treat me as if I was saying that I was God, which I always denied. And in fact, there are many records in the Bible itself that I've denied it. But they still want to believe that I am God. And the main reason why they want to believe that is because they want to have a human they can relate to as if they're God. Because we're so blocked to God. So we want to have somebody who we can see, feel, touch, and work out, that's what God must be like. Mary, you want to ask?
Just from what you're saying, it seems like I understand why people want to deitize or make into God a person, because they feel so blocked to God for those reasons. But doesn't that also indicate that within each of us there is an inbuilt yearning for God?
Of course. Yeah. Underlying all of this is that we all do want to connect to God at some point. There is this sort of hole in humanity that exists. There's two holes that exist in your soul. One hole that exists in your soul, when I say it's a hole, it's more like an underlying inbuilt desire that exists in your soul, and that is a desire to connect with your Creator. That's one of the holes. The second hole that most people don't have fulfilled in themselves is a desire to connect to their perfect partner. That's the second major hole that exists in our relationships. And so what we do is we substitute, because there's so much pain associated generally with those two particular issues, those two particular longings that we have that are inside of our soul, we then substitute relationships for those particular relationships. So for most people, they finish up substituting a relationship with a human in place of God. Now, for many of us, it's substituting our father for our relationship with God. Many people do that, actually. In other words, their father takes on the role of the authority. They then try to do whatever their father wants. They try to please their father and so forth. If it's not their father, then it's usually a religious organisation of some kind that is meant to be God's representative. They then have a relationship with that religious organisation, which is a part of them trying to work through their issues with their relationship with God.
Is that why we have trouble relating to the female side of God, because most of these people have been male?
Yes, very much so. Yeah. And in fact, this is a major problem on the planet as well. The amount of... And by the way, there were times in history when people believed God was female only and not male, by the way. We went through these cycles historically where the female was viewed to be God. And if you talk about God, it was always viewing it as God our mother and not never a father. And mankind has been through these cycles periodically where we believe God is the mother, and then there was a rejection of that, and then there was an acceptance of God being the father, and then there was a rejection of that, and then there was an acceptance of God being mother, but never like both masculine and feminine at the same time. And as a result of that, there has been periods of time in humanity where women dominated the planet, completely dominated the planet. They were involved in all aspects of politics, all aspects of religion, and men were not allowed to be involved in those things during those times. And then, of course, there was this backlash by men as a result of that unbalance. And then men used their strength and their will to overcome those belief systems, and now we have a male-dominated society. But historically, we've gone through cycles where women have dominated, men have dominated, women have dominated, men have dominated, and there's been no equality through these cycles. Yeah. And in fact, if you look at some of the religious artefacts that you can see through archaeology, you can see how much women were revered in historical terms through history, but not so much now. So if you look at all the deities that are involved in religions now, it's only the Hindu religion, really, that as a major religion that believes in feminine deities. The Christian religion, it's all masculine deities. The Muslim religion, all masculine deities. And these are all of these are because of the general swing in the population as to who they accept God to be. Yep. Historically, there's many artefacts that archaeologists have found that prove that there were feminine deities in many religions on the planet. And in fact, some different races on the planet had only feminine deities, actually, no masculine deities at all. And these were cycles that the planet went through in terms of their viewpoint of God. So if you add up all of these problems, you can see that the biggest issues we have are with God, generally. So when we start talking about relationship with God, everyone's going, okay. Like, and there's not much of a connection to it because there are just so many obstacles that we have within us that we've got to get over before we contemplate having a relationship with God. And the obstacles are like pretty major obstacles. In addition to that, because we believe God is a punishing God, we're not allowed to experience anger with God, is the belief that the most people have in themselves. And so, in fact, most people are petrified of actually expressing anger and rage towards God. So they never do. They never do actually even get below their addictions with God. As a result. Remember, anger is always a result of some addiction. And so therefore, if we have rage with God but can't even express it and are in complete denial of the rage that we have towards God, then it's going to be very, very difficult for us to ever find the addiction we have with God, what we expect God to do for us as to why we get so angry with God. And because we believe God is a punishing God, it's almost like we feel there's this feeling which is there's a word for it and the word escapes me. It's a feeling that many of us have that we're terrified. Superstitious is the feeling, I suppose, would be the best way of describing it, where we have this deep superstition inside of us that maybe God is like that, you know, like, and there's this underlying feeling in most of society that of superstition, where they're always a bit suspicious of God and therefore don't sort of see God as a loving God, but somebody who, you know, somebody who's going to require something of them at some point, and they've got to just be careful with their life. And it's interesting, when you talk to even the most confirmed atheist, there is often underlying feelings of superstition that are in them, that are a part of this history, that are part of mankind's history. And this superstitious nature that we have with God has caused us to do all sorts of very, very damaging things with God. This whole concept that is presented in the Bible, in the Old Testament of the Bible, that the Israelite race were allowed to destroy other races, was all based on superstition about an angry God. And so when another race sacrificed their children to God, the Israelite race condemned that, and they decided that they were going to be God's, if you like, sword of correction for that other race. And the Israelite race, as they proceeded through what they called the Promised Land, they eventually murdered whole races, fathers, mothers, children, everybody, and totally destroyed the race completely through their superstitions that they had with God. And I find it interesting that Christianity, a lot of Christian belief principles were based on that kind of treatment of other people. So when you look at all of the different injuries and emotional feelings that we have with God, it's pretty intense, eh? It's like, Karen?
So to deal with that injury that we have, that we feel that God is punishing, because I get a bit confused with that, I feel that I go into kind of self-punishment with it. Is it just a matter of really allowing that grief that you feel like you're being punished by God?
Yeah, can I show you how this belief gets established in us quite, as a firm belief, quite young? You see, when we are being brought up by our parents, we learn quite early in our life, generally, that if we punish ourselves, then we can escape the punishment of others. Does that make sense? So many of us emotionally, what we do is we grow up into this place where we learn, and usually we learn it quite young, where our parents sort of lecture us a bit. You know, we've done something wrong, which is fine. Our parents need to give us some form of correction about something wrong. But instead of just giving us correction that's love and truth-based, most of the time it's also guilt-based. In other words, the parent's trying to make us feel guilty so that we don't do the thing again. And what we learn in that process is that it's actually better to punish ourselves than to receive punishment from another person. It actually feels easier. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
it also feels less destructive to our soul, because when we receive punishment from the other person, we have a heap of emotions, including total rejection, feelings of abandonment, and quite a lot of other very, very difficult feelings for a child to address if they were totally open emotionally. So what they learn to do instead is they learn to blame themselves for what went wrong. And so we learn to punish ourselves. But if you think about it, the only reason why we punish ourselves is to avoid the prospect of being punished by others. So emotionally, what we're doing when we're punishing ourselves is we're avoiding the prospect of being punished eventually by God. We're hoping that if we punish ourselves enough, God will actually be easy on us. Does that make sense? Now, if you look at the Christian faiths, for example, that are on the planet at the moment, this is rife in most of these Christian faiths, this whole idea of self-sacrifice, punishment. And even they have parts of different faiths, and there's a part of the Catholic faith that is like this as well, where they actually have whips that they whip themselves when they notice they've done something wrong, and that way they demonstrate their repentance towards the God who would otherwise punish them if they hadn't have realised. And there is a very strong group of people in the Catholic religion who still believe in that as a form of repentance with their relationship with God. So, yeah, this whole punishing God situation has caused us then to revert to this self-punishment as well. And so what we end up doing is we end up noticing when we've done something wrong, but we want to punish ourselves for doing that wrong thing. And the reason why we want to punish ourselves is because, the reason why we do is because we feel afraid that somebody else will punish us if we don't punish ourselves. But the problem with that is we never address the underlying causal reason, the actual reason why we did that thing. So for example, let's say you did something, you know, during the day where, you know, you had the opportunity to steal and then you took the opportunity, and it was just a small thing, but, you know, that was the feeling inside of you. It was just a small thing, and you don't even know why you did it, and you even feel frightened about why you did it, right? Let's say. If you believe in a punishing God, you will have a high likelihood to try and punish yourself about it. You'll feel guilty that you did it. You'll feel bad about yourself. You'll feel like you can't talk to anybody else about it, because if you do, they'll feel like you're guilty and they'll feel you're bad as well. So you try and hold on to it all inside of yourself. And you dream about it. And you have all sorts, you know, for a few days you can't sleep. And, you know, all sorts of things happen as a result. Interestingly, though, what doesn't happen in most cases is looking at the reason why. And the reason why we don't go to the reason why is because we're so involved in either punishing ourselves or avoiding a punishing God or avoiding, you know, other people from thinking that we're bad and all those kind of things, that we never get below that to actually find out the reason why we did it. And then, of course, it doesn't get resolved. And then so months later or years later, we do the same thing. And then that adds to the previous feeling and then it doesn't get resolved. And can you see how the turmoil inside just builds and builds and builds without ever being resolved?
And what about when something bad happens, like an accident or something like that? And so, and then the feeling I have is that I'm being punished by God. Like that's a reflection that I've done something wrong and it's kind of a punishment from
yep.
God for not doing something.
Most accidents actually occur out of self-punishment, actually. Mm. It's a soul thing that we attract when we desire to punish ourselves. And generally, most accidents, even of children, are a result of a desire to self-punish or a desire for attention. In children as well. So quite often in children, children don't get attention until something, they don't get a hug until something happens that is wrong, bad, you know, to them. So, you know, they fall over, then they get a hug. Yeah. But generally, many, many children, particularly if you think of our my age group, so 50 plus age group, if you look at that age group, many times you didn't get a hug at all unless something bad happened, right? Most people would consider my mother to be a loving person, but my mother never hugged me in my entire life. So what do? You create accidents and then you get the hug. You know, then you get the attention that you feel you're missing. And that is a very common action on the part of a child. But it's also part of self-punishment in the sense of when you feel guilty about something, or you feel angry with things, generally there is this attraction that occurs immediately that causes accidents to occur. Yeah. And we can talk about, there are a multitude of causes for accidents, of course, but that is a big underlying factor. Yeah.
Thank you.
And it's interesting, we then go down the track of going, oh, God doesn't like me. You know, God's punishing me as well. I did that wrong and look at it like I've got this result. And this just reinforces these beliefs about a cruel God. Does that make sense? Like, and this is the problem on the planet. We keep reinforcing these totally inaccurate beliefs about God. We reinforce them over and over and over again. Yeah. I wanted to ask a question.
I don't want to take you off topic, but when you say that accidents were...
Could you just put the mic a bit closer?
When you said that accidents were self... punishment. It's a major part of my condition.
Yeah.
Accidents and from when I was a small child. So I hadn't thought of it as self-punishment.
When you're a small child, it begins with the feelings of your parents. Mm. So if your child starts having accidents, it's because of different feelings that they're having from their parents that cause the child to have accidents. Normally a child is very, usually by the time a child is 2 or 3 years of age, and even before then, if a child has been brought up in a very safe and loving environment, the child is very spatially aware. And by the time of age of 7, generally a child is perfectly spatially aware. In other words, they know exactly what they can do with their body and what they can get away with without hurting their body. Most children after that time still having accidents is an indication that there is no spatial awareness inside of them. And if there's no spatial awareness, it's because of something that's happened with regard to the space that their parents want to be involved in their life too much, or there's something going on between their relationship with themselves and their parents that causes them to have a lack of spatial awareness. And that is also something we impose upon God as well. Every time we have these feelings with our parents, we then start to believe our parents, God is like our parents. So this is one reason why people are addicted to rebellion with God as well, is because they feel that God will get too involved in their life and cause too much change. And so they'd prefer God only be a Sunday morning thing, you know, or if that, or the occasional, you know, I stand on a mountain and look at the view and think, oh, you're a lovely God. You know, that's the occasional worship or feelings that most people would prefer to have with God. Rather than having a day-to-day interaction that changes their entire life. And so most of our parents have a deep also resistance to having having children daily interacting in their life. And as a result of that, most parents feel quite overwhelmed when they have their children. I don't know how many of you have had children, but if you think back to the very first child you had, for most parents, that was pretty scary, the first child in particular. And that's why a lot of times the first child is very, very involved emotionally with their parents, trying to assuage the parents' feelings of that they don't know what they're doing with this first child. And as a result of that, when the parents have any different emotions towards the child then will either go into a feeling of being rejected, which it then tries to avoid by being self-punishing. And when it becomes self-punishing, it then gets the reward of the cuddle or the reward of the re-establishment of the relationship. And so accidents often occur frequently as a result in a person who hasn't felt very loved in their childhood, except when the accidents have actually occurred. Yeah.
Just going back to the hugging of the children. Mm-hmm. So if you hug your children quite a lot, how do you know, because being in error as a parent, you're not doing it from a needy point of view and you're doing it from pure love?
Well, if you hug your children and the reason why you're hugging them is so that you can feel something yourself, then that is an addiction. If the reason why you're hugging them is so that you can help them feel your love, then that's more pure desire, isn't it? So for many people, and this is a problem on the planet for many of us do have children, and many women have children, so that they will be looked after at some point in the future or be loved. There is this concept that's very similar to the animal concept that many people have when they have a pet, and that is this idea that an animal will love you unconditionally, and there's this idea that a child will love you unconditionally. They are addictions. When we are in true state of love with our children, we can love them even if they totally have nothing to do with us. We can still love them. And we can still feel those feelings of love for them rather than feeling resentful. When the child is very small, like yours, we often have feelings of love for them in the sense that we want to care for them because they cannot care for themselves and so forth. But at the same time, we often also have feelings that of this lovely feeling we have being able to nurture the child, and that's what we've got to be careful of, because it's that emotion that finishes up developing into an addiction. And we've got to be careful that we don't have these addictions with our children, because the children will then feel bound to us, and we don't want our children to feel bound to us. We are not actually their parent. The true parent of your child is God. So, and all you've done is create two bodies for this child of God. Through the process of intercourse, you've created the spirit body and the material body in conception. And then this child of God incarnated and connected to you as a result. So if most parents had the attitude that this is a child of God that I am caring for, they would probably feel less bound in and wanting the child to be less bound to them, and they'd be more interested in helping the child connect to God instead. Now, that doesn't mean the parent wouldn't love the child, because of course the parent would. The whole reason why you have one is because you want to share your love with the child. And the whole reason why God had her children was that she wanted to share her love with her children. So it's the same principle. But God didn't want to get love from her children. God doesn't have an addiction for our love. And whenever we impose the same addiction to our child, we finish up damaging our child. Yep. So these are problems, of course, that are all part of the gender-based emotional injuries that we have generally. And unfortunately, you know, it just gets carried down generation to generation to generation. And before you know it, we have so many injuries with God, far more injuries with God than we have with any other being. And as a result of that, when we start talking about God, we start reflecting upon, you know, if we talk about God in a positive sense, it's almost like our ears are turned off. It's like, na 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 na, you know, like in terms of our discussion about God. And then we hear the word soulmate, was that soulmate that I heard? I've got an ear open now, you know, like, or you know. Emotion, yeah, or heard pleasure, sex, yes, I'll talk about that one. And we sort of have this closed viewpoint when we're talking about God, And then when we're talking about other subjects, where there's a degree of openness at least present. But and this is what we've got to, if we really want to understand the universe and understand everything in it and understand ourselves completely, we need to be sincere about working through our issues with God. And we need to be sincere about where we are about it as well. What we really do feel about God, we need to be sincere about. You know, many people who are religious, when you talk to them, and I've spoken in my life to millions of people who are religious, you know, many people who are religious believe concepts of God that they never voice in their religion, but they actually feel them quite strongly. And I've had a conversation even with my own mother about, she's a member of a religion, and a Christian religion, and I've had discussions with her about God, for example, and what I've found in every discussion is that she actually believes that God is cruel and punishing. One of the reasons why she worships God is because she has this feeling that she wants to connect to God. But on the other hand, she is not open-hearted in her connection with God because she actually believes that from her perspective, her words, she says there's 50 million children that die every year of starvation on this planet and God's not doing a thing about it. Now you ask, if you're honest with yourself and other people, that is an issue that most people have with God. You know, most people have this feeling that, you know, if it was me, if I was God, I'd be doing something about it. Why? God's not doing anything about it. What's wrong with God? God mustn't be as loving as I am, is the automatic assumption after that, right? And so there's a lot of what I would classify as misconceptions and misunderstandings that people have about God that they don't even allow themselves to voice in their day-to-day life, right? And if you don't voice them, you're never going to face them emotionally. And if you don't face them emotionally, you're never going to be able to have a relationship with God. Because you'll carry them in the relationship. It's a bit like if I believe Mary's going to cheat on me every single day of our life together, can I have an open and close relationship with Mary? If that's my belief. If I believe Mary's going to be dishonest with me, or Mary's going to be cruel with me, like I'll be constantly, every single day, looking for... Can you see? I'll be constantly looking every single day for times when Mary seems to be, she might be heading in that direction, even. Does that make sense? Yeah. Mary, you want to?
It's a question. So what I feel is, in order to connect...
If you turn around that way and look at me, okay. Then Joy will have a bit more joy looking.
Sorry, Joy. In order to connect to God...
Yep.
I'm going to need to be brave enough to grieve these feelings.
Yep.
Many of these feelings are
and also me. Remember that the whole of humanity has them, so you're also going to have to be brave enough to confront the whole of humanity in the process.
Their opposition to me.
Their opposition to you state. Dealing with these feelings.
Yeah. My question is about faith.
Mm-hmm.
So where does faith fall into this equation? Where do I decide to trust a different... truth, I suppose, because the emotional truth is that I feel God, I believe these things about God,
yep,
to some degree, maybe not everything on your list. Where does my faith enter or my trust?
Yeah, I understand the question. So the big problem we have, of course, is if we have these emotional beliefs about God, then how are we ever going to have a relationship with God? There's a big problem. And then secondly, well, if these are emotions within me already, how do I ever have the faith that these are not true? Because the feeling that I have is all of these things are true. Like, that's the feeling I have inside of myself, that it is true that God's cruel, and it is true that God doesn't care, and it is true that God's wrathful and punishing, and it is true the only person that I can rely on is myself. And it is true, why would I want to connect with a God who's just a cruel, punishing, wrathful person? I'd rather just rebel against that God and do my own thing, you know? And it is true that, you know, while I have all these agenda-based emotional beliefs that I'm imposing on God, well, God's not doing anything about that. You know, God's not correcting. God's not showing to the world that God's different than this. You know, and these are all feelings generally that are present in most people. So when all of these feelings are present, what do we do with them? Like, how do we have faith that God is different to that? That's a pretty good question, isn't it? Like, because you're going to have at least some faith that God's different than that before you try to address these emotions. Because if you look at it from a purely pragmatic perspective, when we look at these issues in our day-to-day life, how many times have you been able to truly rely on another individual for your life? Truly. Now, you ask the average person that, how can they, you know, in stressful situations with every single person who's around you, how many people have you actually been able to rely on other than yourself? Now, for many people, they'd have to honestly say zero. Right? And for most people who don't say zero, it's very rare that it's any more than five in their entire life. Right? Now, that understandably, from a pragmatic point of view, tends to indicate that I should rely on myself. That's the only person I can rely on to look out for me. Does that make sense? And from a pragmatic perspective, how can I change my mind on that issue? I've got no proof I can rely on anybody else. My whole life seems to be proof in the opposite direction to that. Then we look at this issue of, you know, a God who doesn't care or punishing or whatever. And we ask ourselves questions about what's happening in the world. How many times have you seen something in the course of one day that was totally unfair? What you believe is totally unfair? Now, for most people, they'd have to answer that yes, pretty much every day of their life they observe something that's totally unfair. Yeah, what they believe is totally unfair. Now, if God created this system of things, that means God is okay with it being unfair. Does it not? So I'm getting a feeling that God's unfair. So what's my pragmatic feeling associated with that is, no, God is unfair. Like, I don't see any proof otherwise, right? So how can I have faith when I don't see any proof otherwise? It's very hard, right? So this is why the average person gives up the whole emotional reflection upon all of these subjects, because it becomes very, very difficult. Then they look at this whole thing of God meeting my addictions. How many times have you, in very, very difficult times of your life, pray to God for something to occur in a positive direction and it never has? Have all of you experienced that at some point? Most people.
In that teenage romance.
Mike, maybe. In the teenage romance, yeah.
Surely in that teenage romance that we talked about yesterday, a lot of people prayed to God that he would come back and love me.
Yeah. So oftentimes we have all of this, these so-called prayers that we have towards God, where we're long and long and long for something to happen, doesn't happen. You think of how many people who are religious who are involved in war pray in that way, or who've been involved in the results of war, like, you know, people coming through and raping and pillaging their countryside, their safety. They pray for God to keep them safe and it doesn't appear like God keeps them safe and they die, or they get raped, or they get hurt in some way. So when we look at that from a pragmatic perspective, we go, yeah, God's not doing anything there either. Like, so how can I have any faith that God's anything different or even exists if God doesn't do all these things? Like, you exist and you want to do something about it, even if you don't feel like you have the power to do it. And therefore, if God really wanted to do something about it, you feel that God should. But it appears like God either doesn't want to, doesn't care, or doesn't exist as a result of these things occurring, yes? If we're honest with ourselves, that's usually where we go emotionally. And what I'm saying is that, yes, all of those belief systems are all present within us, right? And they're all present within us because of what has happened to us in our life, because of what we believe is the lack of response from God. And as a result of that, it's very, very difficult for us to engage a conversation about what God is really like, because we already have established through what we see happening in the world what God appears to be. And so therefore we accept that. Right. So that sound pretty negative? Yep, that's good. So the question Mary asked was how can we have some faith that God is different to that? Now, how does faith get established? Now, I've given some talk about faith some time ago, and we've talked about faith and how it gets established. It can only get established through some actual event occurring that gives you the faith. Does that make sense? There has to be some proof before faith can develop. But you have to engage the possibility of proof. And what I mean by that is we have to allow for the fact that we might be wrong, and that all of these things that we think and all of these things that have happened to us might have an alternative reason. Does that make sense? So we need to allow for that to be a possibility before we can even begin to hope to have any faith that God is different. We need to allow for the fact that, yes, these bad things happen on the earth, but that doesn't necessarily mean that God is a punishing God or a wrathful God. We need to allow for the fact that there might be an alternative explanation that is reasonable and logical, and therefore an alternative explanation that we can use as a basis for developing a different concept about God. We also then look at ourselves, because this one here in particular is very, or these two here are very much related to how we ourselves feel. And that's very much related to our upbringing. So we also need to bear in mind that everything that's happened to me could potentially have happened to me because of different things that are out of harmony inside of me because of my upbringing. We need to allow for that possibility too. Rather than just going, well, no, everything that's happening to me is bad, that's bad, has to be brought upon me by this punishing, cruel, unloving God, right, who's trying to correct me and I don't understand. So we need to firstly allow, and whenever, if we're going to develop any faith whatsoever, we need to firstly allow that all of these injuries, and of course we could list more, all of these particular things, issues that we have with God, we may have... the wrong concept. We need to allow for the fact that because everything that happens, nobody on this planet seems to know very much about the human body for a start. Isn't that not true? Like doctors, whenever you have an illness of some kind, doctors flounder as to what the underlying cause is. They give you a pill or something to get rid of the effects, but it's very, very hard for them to determine what the underlying cause is. So even with the basic problems of our human body, we flounder when it comes to, or founder, I suppose, flounder is a fish. is it flounder or founder? Flounder? Yeah. We flounder. Sounds so funny. Used to flounder fish when I was young. We flounder when it comes to actually understanding why it happens. We don't understand. And if we don't understand why something happens, then how can we ever understand the underlying, fix the underlying causes? So bearing in mind that it doesn't seem like even very, very educated people on this planet know very much, then we must also then from that assume that when it comes to our analysis of God, we may also be wrong. If our analysis of ourself is often flawed, then how can we expect our analysis of a being that potentially is more powerful than ourselves, how can we expect that to be accurate? Right. Now, if we start with the concept that we may be wrong, then we can start to at least begin the idea or have some faith that there might be a different concept of God that we need to discover. All right? And And the only way to really obtain faith that is certain is to actually engage a process of discovery, to actually decide to engage it without, at this point, firming any belief system about it. So I don't know if you think about your childhood with regard to going to school. You know how you were sent off to school, usually by mum and dad. You're 5 years old and they start teaching you the ABCs and the 1, 2, 3s if you haven't already learnt them, right? Now, if you look at what they're doing teaching you those particular things, they're teaching you what you call to be the foundation of language and the foundation of mathematics, the foundation of learning. Now, as a child, you didn't go, oh, I don't want to learn that. Because for most children, they are far more open than that, aren't they? They just say, oh, okay, that's what they want to teach me, so I'll learn that and I'll ask questions about it. And before you know it, the child's engaged in the process of learning. And the child engages this process of learning automatically without resistance, without any real belief systems associated with it at that point in time. Can you see that? Now, if we revert to that kind of learning with regard to God, we would be far better off than trusting what the world tells us about God. But what we do is we wait for everybody else to tell us about God, because we don't connect to God personally. We have to connect to other people who say they're connected to God. And as a result of that, we trust what they say about God. So this is what happens from a perspective of religion. Instead of it being, you know, somebody learning the basics and then discovering more complicated things through the process of learning, just like we learnt mathematics and just like we learnt language, the problem with religion is that it's all told to us without us going through a process of learning. In other words, they tell us the belief systems. Even from a very young age, you think of when you were going... Did any of you go to Sunday school? Yes? A few? Yep. What did you find? You were being told. You didn't have the process of discovery. You had the process of just being told. This is how God is. This is what happened. And it was all the certainty. Right? There was no gradual learning involved in the process where you learnt the basics of discovery, how to discover. See, when you were taught mathematics, you were taught numbers first, and then you were taught how to use, manipulate numbers and how to add them and subtract them and multiply them and divide them. And then you went on to more complex things with regard to mathematics. That's how you learnt mathematics. And for some of us, we got add, plus, minus, multiply, divide, and that's about as far as we went. And for others, because we were fascinated in the subject, we went right the way through into algebraic equations and right the way into calculus and right the way into scientific and mathematical equations and right into the depths of mathematics as a result of this process of learning how to learn about it. But none of us have been taught how to learn about God, if you think about it. We've just been told what God is. We haven't been told how to learn about God. And what we need to do if we're going to develop any faith is what we need to do is first start with the basis of, well, everything we're told may be wrong. Everything that we've been told may be wrong. Because it was just people telling us. We never went through any process of discovery of this. It was just somebody telling me information that I then accepted. And I felt a very strong emotional reason to accept it, because whenever I didn't accept it, the minister or priest or mother or father who wanted to tell me it often got angry with me. And so, of course, you know, that was a great motivation to accept it. Right? And so we must accept that, firstly, everything that we've been told may be wrong about God. Secondly, that it's possible, given that people on earth are loving or have the capacity at least to love, right? That this love must have come from somewhere. That would make a logical sense, wouldn't it? If I, inside of myself, have the capacity to love, have the capacity to tell the truth, have the capacity for wisdom, have the capacity to understand, or in other words, to absorb knowledge, then it would make sense that any person who has said to have created me, assuming that such a person exists, would also have the same capacities to a greater degree. Would not that make sense? Yes? So from a logical perspective, it would make sense that if God exists, then God would have a larger capacity for love than I do, that God would have a larger capacity for truth than I do, that God would have a larger capacity for wisdom, power, knowledge, and any other thing that I can think of that exists as a quality inside of myself. God must have a larger capacity than I do for any of those qualities. And if that's the case, then I can start having this idea or faith, if you like, that perhaps, if there is a God, perhaps this God is more loving, more truthful, more wise, more powerful, more knowledgeable than I am. Now, if we look at the issue of God being more loving than I am, for example, I don't want to punish my children forever when my children do something wrong. How many of you have had children? Have you wanted to punish your children forever when they did something wrong? None of you. And yet, the religions tell you that if a person dies having done things wrong that they're not sorry for, that God is going to punish them forever. Now, to me, I can now have some faith that if I have, through this logical discussion of knowledge, I can have some faith that if I would never punish my child forever, surely God, who would have to have more love, more knowledge, more wisdom, more power, more understanding, more truth than I do, surely God wouldn't do it. That's a pretty valid assumption, isn't it? If that God exists, he wouldn't do it. So I can only get down to the point with, does he exist or does he exist at the end of that? Because if God exists, he or she does have more love, more truth, more knowledge, more power, more wisdom, and more every other quality that I have than I have. That's the reality. So now it really gets down to, firstly, determining whether God exists or not. And how do you know whether something exists that you can't see? Like, all of you accept that wind exists, yes? You can't see it, but what do you see? So
you can actually see the effect of it.
You see the effects of it. Yeah. What else?
You can feel it.
You can feel it. So you see the effects of it and you feel it. So how do you measure things you can't see? There's only two real ways. Can you see that? There's only two real ways of measuring something you can't see. You either have to feel it or see the effects of it. They're the only two ways. So the same applies with God. Can you see that? The only way that we're going to ever develop a relationship with God properly is that we're going to have to either do one or both of those two things, because we can't see God. So we have to either feel God or see the effects of God. We have to do one of those two things. Now, in terms of developing faith, how do we do that? So let's look at the first thing, seeing the effects of God. Now, I believe seeing the effects of God, or let's call it seeing God's creations, like when the wind blows, it creates all sorts of things, doesn't it? It creates the trees swaying. You feel this pressure on your face, right? You see the leaves blowing, like flowing through the wind. And if you put some smoke in the air, you'll see the smoke flowing in the direction of the wind. There's all these effects that the wind has, yes, on the process. So if we apply the same thing to another thing that we can't see, and that is God, then it would make sense that if we examine God's creation, we might see some effects of God. Something that we can see God must exist in. Does that make sense? And then secondly, as we pointed out earlier, secondly, what was the second? There was seeing and then feeling. Now, I feel that's much more difficult, to feel God. Because to feel God, I've got all these problems with God. And to feel God, and if God's none of these things, feeling God's going to be pretty difficult. Can you see that? So feeling God initially is going to be much more difficult than seeing God through creation. Now, if you examine, for most of you who believe in God, you've already examined creation to a fair degree, haven't you? And you look at the complexity of creation, you go, wow, there's a lot of intelligence in creation, is there not? And we start examining the intelligence, and to be frank, most of humanity have no idea of the amount of intelligence in creation. Like, do you know that your entire body is designed around a series of numbers, for example? Are you aware of that? Most people are not aware of that. Their entire body, and it's usually only when we're taught art that we start to see the relationship between the numbers and how our body is designed. Can I describe that? Okay, let's do that, because this is a part of seeing God's creation and then making some valid assumptions based on what we see. Have any of you counted the number of rows in a pineapple or a pine cone that goes around in one direction and then it goes around in another? Have you ever done that? It's very interesting. If you look at a pine cone from its stem down, it's sort of circular in nature, isn't it? And there's the middle of the stem. You'll find that there's these rotational things that go around one direction, and in one direction, there's 8 of them. And then if you follow the rotational directions around in the other direction, you'll find there is always 13 of them. That's what you'll find. And if you count a pineapple, there'll be 13 in one direction and 21 in the other direction. Right. And that's usually always the case.
Sorry, AJ, one was a pine cone and one was a pineapple?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Now, if we get all of those things and we interpolate them into a numbering system, you'll find there's a number system that goes like this, where you get the previous number, you start with 0 and you add 1 to it, and then you add the previous 2 numbers together. So the next number in the sequence is 1, and then 1 and 1 is 2, 1 and 2 is 3, 2 and 3 is 5, 5 and 3 is 8, 5 and 8 is 13. 13 and 8 is 21. 21 and 13 is 34. 21 and 34 is 55. And the number just keeps on going up, going up, going up, going up ad infinitum, right? Now, a very, very interesting thing happens, and that is this. If you get one of the numbers that are higher up, like 55, and divide it by 34, you'll find there's always, the higher the number gets, it always approximates this number, 1.618. And that number has some interesting characteristics in that if you invert it, in other words, you go 1 divided by 1.618, you'll find that that will be equal to 0.618. Right? And a pineapple and a pine cone fits within that relationship of its fronds. And in fact, most plants that grow every leaf in a rotation of 0.618 from the previous leaf. And there's a reason why they do that. It's because it has the highest, it's the number with the highest packing density. So in other words, you'll fit the most seeds and the most leaves in a packing density where they all receive light at that rotation, at that rotational angle. Now, how does that relate to your body? Well, these two numbers, 0.618 and 1.618, are very interesting, right? because that defines the relationship of every joint in your entire body. Now, I'll draw a very basic person here, but I have to draw them with their joints. All right, and we make his arms, we do the same with his arms. And his hands. And his hands aren't proportioned. Now, most people who learn about art and drawing the human figure in art learn this as a basic part of their art course. And the reason why is that every single one of our bodies, yours and mine, are built to the same relationship. And this is how it is. If you take the height of the person, right, as one in terms of a relationship, then where their belly button will be 0.618 as a multiple of that. So if you're, let's say you're 157 centimetres, if you multiply that by 0.618, that will be the height of your belly button. If you take every joint from, like, your hip joint and your from your length of your leg, right, then 0.618 will be where your knee is. If you take your knee to the end of your toes, 0.618, it happens to be where your ankle joint is. The same applies to your arm, from your shoulder to there, 0.618 is your elbow. And from there to there, 0.618 is your wrist. If you take your face and measure its length, the bottom of your nose is 0.618 from the top of your head. And the top of your nose is 0.618 from the bottom of your chin. Do you know that? And they've known this for thousands of years, yes? Because when they teach you drawing classes of the human body in art school, they teach you this. Yeah? Does that make sense? Now, the question then becomes, that's a fair bit of mathematical design, is it not? That's pretty consistent across every human form. That also seems to be consistent in things like a pineapple, a pine cone, and in fact, in the way that the rotational way in which plant leaves are created. If you look at a sunflower head, it has the same rotational figures, but with higher numbers. All of those things are all related. Now, hang on a sec. Like, if all things came into existence through some kind of spontaneous process, then surely it would all be random, wouldn't it? But it's not. It's not random. It's all got a certain type of a design. So the question has to be asked, well, does design come about without a designer? When you designed your house, or when you look at a house that somebody else has designed, you go, wow, that just spontaneously came into existence without anybody putting it together, without anybody maintaining it. You don't, do you? And yet something far more complicated, your own body, which most of us don't even understand the basics of. Like, I would classify this as one of the basic things about your human body. That's one of the least mathematical things that have happened in your human body. And the average person on this planet knows nothing about it, right? But to me, it is evidence of seeing something that God has created. Because to do that requires design. And whenever you have design, there has to be a designer. That makes sense, doesn't it? Logically? Okay. So I see that as something to do with God. Like, the fact that design exists means that there has to be some kind of designer. And the fact that this design exists in many living things is an indication that there has to be a designer that created all those living things. A very similar designer, the same designer probably, yes? If you saw a house that looked the same and you saw 25 of them in a row, you'd probably assume that the same person built them, would you not? Well, there's 6.5 or so billion people on this planet, all with the same design. Like, my presumption is the same person built that design. Yeah?
It's quite funny when you think about it, because if it wasn't by design and it was just random, what would the human race look like?
Yeah, imagine. And this is where the whole concept of alien species comes about, right? And if you look at shows like, what was it, you know, the Star Wars shows, you know, how they've got all of these strange characters. And the reason why they look so strange to us is because they're all out of harmony with design, with this design. Right? That's why they look strange. And so we need to understand that these designs are all a part of what we see on this planet. They're all very, very similar designs. Now, to me, that's a part of seeing the effects of God's wind blowing. Yes? It's the same. That's how I see it. The effects of the breeze that is God, God's creation. So it helps me see what God has done and therefore believe that potentially God must exist, because I can see there is all this design in what God has done. And this is just one, like, this is a very minor thing. And even though it's minor, shells have the same rotational angles, plants have the same rotational angles, we have the same rotational angles. Even the way the hairs appear on our head are in the same rotational angles. In addition to that, the universe in galaxies have the same rotational angles as well. So it goes from what appears to be some of the smallest things in creation right the way through to immensely large things all have these same rotational angles and same mathematical relationships. Now that tells me that, right, okay. If you just saw it in one thing, you'd go, oh, that's pretty amazing. But if you saw it in two or three things, you start going, well, obviously the same kind of person made those things, right? Or the same being made those things. But if you're starting to see it from everything down to a universal structure, like a galaxy, down to, you know, what we see in like plant-based materials, and even into smaller structures than that, then I'd start to go, wow, that's a pretty big effect, right? Of the wind of God that blows. There's someone that I can't see. Now, I've only brought up one thing because there's literally, as you can imagine, there's literally millions of mathematical things of far more complex nature than that that we could discuss that all prove God, you know, it's God's existence.
To me, I think all the problems that were listed was God, like the wrathful God, all these belief systems. If the veil was lifted for afterlife, for spirit world, we would see that we can't really kill each other. We would see that God's laws are in operation for people that did unloving things on earth.
Yep.
We would see that we not come from a monkey or a fish, because there's a spirit side to us that we most scientists don't look at.
Yes.
So the question is, why is such a heavy veil still exist for the afterlife?
The heavy veil only exists because of all of the emotions that we listed. You see, what happens is that when we do not want to face that we hold on to certain emotions, we finish up living in the emotions rather than releasing them. When we live in the emotions, our mind is completely blocked to an alternative viewpoint. So it's a bit like, if you believe that somebody is not a nice person and you never release that emotion, you will carry that belief to your grave, will you not? They might even do philanthropic things and they might do lovely things, but you'll always say, yeah, but I just can't trust them. Because there's an emotion in you that prevents the trust. And it's exactly the same with us, with everything that we look at. The only reason why we are not open to new thought or new ideas is because we have an emotional thing preventing us from being open to it. And it's the emotion we need to address or deal with if we are truly going to learn. If we are closed in any way emotionally, we are going to be closed to whole areas of investigation. For example, how many of you feel closed to mathematics? Like, where you don't really like the mathematics much, right? Okay. Well, you would never have seen that in your entire life if I hadn't have shown it to you then. Because that's only in books about mathematics and natural mathematics. So you would have looked at the word mathematics and go, pff, pff, you know, like, wouldn't you? Well, I don't want to read that. I want to read something more interesting than that. And you would never have found it out, right? And the reason why is because there was just this emotional blockage to mathematics that would cause you to never even investigate it, yeah? And this is the problem with all of our problems with God, is that we are blocked in so many different areas, and as a result of these emotional blockages, we don't allow the concepts to be changed. Now, when we die and we pass over into the spirit world, there's one concept that immediately changes, and that is that you're still alive and you're not dead forever. So that concept's gone. And that then often challenges people who have passed into challenging other concepts. Sometimes it doesn't, unfortunately, but many times it does. And so they start challenging the other concepts of things they've learned here on the planet. And to do that, they have to challenge their emotions, because their emotions are going to determine their belief structure. Their emotions are going to determine what goes on. So it's always our emotions that prevent us from investigating with an open heart. So this is why I'm saying to you that emotional work is a very, very important part of your relationship with God. Not because in the end it's going to be an important part, but because it prevents relationship and it prevents knowledge. It prevents you from absorbing knowledge when you have not released emotions that prevent the knowledge from being absorbed. So I can have that discussion with a person who's very resistive to God, and I'll say all of that to them, and they'll say, yeah, but that's no proof that God exists. And I'm saying, okay, I see some inconsistencies here. You know, if I took you down for a drive down this road here and showed you every house driving down this road and told you nobody built it, would you accept me saying that to you? And they immediately say, of course not, somebody built it. And I said, okay, somebody built that, which is not very complicated, let's face it. It's like a few beams here and a few blocks here and there, a bit of substances here and there. Compared to my body, it's nothing really in terms of complexity. And yet you're telling me that my body, which is the same design as your body and your body and your body, we all have the same design, and there's millions of them, billions of them, in fact, on the planet. You're telling me that all of those can't have got here, had to have got here by chance, when the house that I'm looking at down the road there, I told you come by chance and you can't accept that. Right? So to me, there's no logic there, right? Once a person starts going down that track. But the reason why there's no logic is because they are totally blocked to the emotional concept of God. That's why there's no logic. Do you follow me? If I refuse to accept there is a God, it's going to block me to a lot of logic. Right? It's going to block me. And this is I gave a talk recently in Melbourne. It was called Logic, Emotions and Truth. And in that talk, I talked about how to determine truth with logic and emotions being used together. Right? And I suggest that anybody who is struggling with determining truth needs to have a listen to that presentation. But if you look at our examination of God, I find that is when we are the most illogical of all. And there's a great reason for why we are the most illogical when we look at God. And it's because we have the most emotional issues with God. And anything that we have an emotional issue about, we're going to have the least amount of logic with. That's the unfortunate truth. So now that we at least can establish, and we could go on forever looking at God's creations, I feel. In fact, the way I feel God's design creation is proof of existence. A-N-C-E-E-N-C-E. E-N-C-E. Right? God has designed creation in the way that God has to prove to us that God exists. That's the whole point of the way in which it's been designed, right? And to me, that then says, okay, God is definitely intelligent. It takes a pretty intelligent being to come up with mathematical formula and then apply it to, like, literally thousands of different of creations throughout the universe in different scales. It's a pretty intelligent being. With a lot of power, of course, too, right? But a very intelligent being. Now, if God's intelligent, and me, using my limited intelligence, goes, yes, and it's not intelligent to fight people, is it? Do you find that? It's intelligent to fight people? Like, you bop somebody in the nose, and what generally happens? They bop you back, and then what do you do if you still want to engage? You bop them back, and what in the end happens? If you're not given a gun, you'll beat each other into a pulp and be so exhausted that you can't even hit each other another time and be hospitalised. And what resulted from the whole thing? Nothing. Right. Now, that's not very intelligent. Right. And I go, well, God's obviously far more intelligent than I am, and I can see that people fighting with each other is not very intelligent. Right? So I'd then feel that means that God feels people fighting each other isn't intelligent either. God would have more intelligence than I have about that issue. This is without even looking at the issue of love, whether it's loving to fight each other or not. Just, is it an intelligent action? No, it's not. It's not something that's clever or logical. So I find through this examination that there are certain qualities immediately through this proof of existence that God has given me of God's existence. There are certain qualities that I can straight away see present in this proof. And the qualities are, one of them is intelligence. Right? I see also a lot of qualities related to love, because I see there's a focus, even in our human bodies, on receiving and giving pleasure. And is our power just doing that? Must be just the light. Yeah. So, it'll be the light one, but please don't turn off the power one. Yeah, because we've got it running from the power. There we go. God said, let there be light, and there was. Yeah. Interesting thing, does that happen when I'm discussing certain matters? So I see the evidence of love in a lot of the creation, right? The evidence of love is present everywhere. I see the evidence of wisdom. I see a lot of what are called symbiotic relationships. You see them too, yes, in creation, where without a certain thing or thing being created, we could not even exist. For example, if there were no trees producing oxygen, we would not survive. There's a symbiotic relationship. There's also a symbiotic relationship in that they absorb what we breathe out. There's a symbiotic relationship in that. So we breathe out, they breathe in. They breathe out, we breathe in. Very symbiotic. And there's so many of these symbiotic relationships which prove wisdom, which prove relationship between these particular things. And I go, okay, this part of examining God through creation, we see proof of God's existence, and we also see not only proof of existence, but we also see proof of other qualities. Intelligence being one of them, love being another, wisdom being another, and so forth. Now, this then has established to me that I can have some faith that God is like that. Can you see that? Because I've now got some proof of existence and proof that these qualities exist in the things that I'm examining in creation, this then allows me to have some faith that there is obviously some way that I can start to feel God. Now, the whole reason in the first century why I discovered that I could receive divine love was all that entire process that I've just described to you. I went through looking at what I saw around me. I saw intelligence in everything around me. I saw love in everything around me in the sense of how it was created in its pristine state, not how man destroyed it, but how it was in its pristine state. And I saw all this wisdom, and then so I then felt very strongly in my heart that God does exist. And then I used a little bit of logic. And the little bit of logic I used, it didn't require very much because I was very young when I did it, was that if God existed and God had intelligence and love and wisdom and those kind of qualities, then it would make sense that there must be some way that I can feel God. And there must be some way that God can feel me. And so I made that presumption that there must be some way, and then for the rest of my life in the first century, I just spent experimenting with finding a way to feel God. Does that make sense? And in that process, I discovered that I could feel God and that God could feel me, and then if I desired to feel God, I could feel a feeling coming from God, and along with those feelings coming from God, which overwhelmed me at the time, I had other things come to me, which is what I discussed with you yesterday, the eternal benefits of this relationship with God. You want to say, Mary?
I don't want to interrupt until you're finished.
Oh, okay. It's already has happened. Far away.
So this is just following on from my initial question.
Mm-hmm. Does that satisfactorily answer your original one about faith?
Well, it deepens my experience of this question. Like, it opens me up to more feelings. And my feeling is really, or my question is a lot of, it's hard because I'm having feelings and questions at the same time and maybe answers at the same time. But there's some kind of feminine quality. I think it's a feminine quality about emotion, which means that when you appeal to my intellect, I like what you say and it makes sense to me, mm-hmm. and it has generated faith in me. Mm-hmm. But there is a dominance, it feels, of emotion inside of me.
Yes.
And this question that I asked is based more on, it's almost like a visceral kind of feeling that I have in entering a new level of faith. Yeah. One that doesn't rely on my intellect, but that challenges my emotion through its existence, through my actions. Mm-hmm. And there's more that I wanted to ask you about this, but...
You haven't asked anything yet?
No. I'm sorry. Sometimes I feel I could talk to you about this in private,
yeah.
and other times I feel that many other people must experience this, and yep. so I don't know whether...
Well, listen, can I discuss the point you're making?
Yeah.
And that is, if you examine number one, this point part here, you can see that we can... This helps us to examine logic, doesn't it?
And I'm aware that I have... that was one of my questions. Like, I have emotions surrounding logic, and I feel many women do.
Many women do, I agree.
From an early time, we are not logical.
Yes.
And we're told that that's a man's domain. And when it comes to connecting with logic emotionally, I think it triggers shame and fear inside of me as well. So is this just part of what I need to process?
Well, no, there are certain... What your original question really is based around, are there certain masculine traits associated with certain ways of understanding things, and are there certain feminine traits with the way we understand things? And the answer is yes. There is certain ways that the masculine side of the soul treats information in comparison to the feminine side of the soul. Both ways are important for the soul itself. They are not mutually exclusive. Does that make sense to everyone? So let me discuss what I mean by this. Logic is generally treated, and when I say generally, these are all generalizations that will be made now. Logic is generally treated as, and it is something more attractive to the male. You can see that men generally feel more attracted to logical explanations than women. Does that make sense? And feeling God has to do with emotions, does it not? So you could put emotions in here. And generally, women process truth firstly by feeling about it rather than thinking about it. So that is a very much a female type of dominant thing to do. Yes? Now, if we think about this as the two halves of the soul, so here's our soul, here's the masculine part of it and the feminine part of it. Can you see that each half is essential for the determining of truth? Can you see that? The logical half is very, very important for the determination of truth, and the emotional part is very important for the determination of truth. When I talk about seeing God's creations and examining God's creations, I am then referring and then making some logical inferences about those particular things that I see. But that is still not feeling God. Right? I also have to be open to this more feminine trait, if you like, which is to be able to sense the truth through emotions. Now, there's only one problem. And that is that generally our emotions on earth are very distorted. They are injured. And for this reason, many people find looking at things emotionally very distorting as well, because the emotions themselves are distorting. Now, if our emotions were completely free of any unlovingness in them, and completely free of any like rebellion and other types of feelings that we had, and they were completely open to absorbing new information emotionally, then can you see this would be a very rapid way of learning the truth about things? But unfortunately, on the planet, the majority of us are very emotionally damaged, and therefore we have emotional injuries. And therefore, we can't always just trust the emotion as a way of determining the truth. Can you see that? We have to add together both of the masculine and feminine traits of determining truth to actually determine truth. And if we don't do that, we're going to have a flaw of some kind or other, in that if we look only at logic without feeling at all, we'll eventually end up with some flaws. And if we look at only emotion without looking at anything logical at all, we'll also end up with flaws. And this is what's very important. Now, for a woman, because there is an automatic association with emotion, more so than the male, she will find determining truth through emotion an easier proposition than determining truth through logic. And because the male has a more dominant feeling of wanting logic than emotion, then he will generally struggle with determining things emotionally as truth. And what we need to do is address both sets of emotional injuries, our injuries towards logic and our injuries towards emotion, if we're truly going to examine all truth and therefore understand everything about God. You see, you can see the only two ways we can feel, we can see something that does not, that cannot be seen by our eyes, there's only two ways. And it's the same, so when we look at the wind, remember we said right at the beginning of this, if we look at the wind, there's only two ways of seeing that it exists. One is by seeing the results of it, which is to do with logic. The other is by feeling it ourselves, which is to do with emotion and feelings, sensations. Mary?
Just to add to that before you rub that off, what I observe in you is that you are able to connect with truth in a logical way, even if it is first intellectually, but that guides your... that can govern your emotional process. Like, you can hold truth while you experience emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And what it feels like to me is that even though I've thought that I've lived a very mind-dominated life, my emotions have governed everything.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I'm so emotional, it scares me, and I'm constantly trying to manage that through my fear.
Mm-hmm.
My feeling, my growing feeling, is that it's an aspect of femininity. Or, you know how you connect to truth readily and this guides your emotions. I feel that for the feminine, or the feminine aspect, I hate that.
You're going to have to allow the ready connection to emotion.
Yes.
Before you will determine truth.
And it feels like a connection to love will guide my emotional process, whereas a connection to truth has led you to emotion and love.
Yes.
I have to connect to love.
Yes, but emotion is the way... Yes. Love is an emotion.
I have to
So logic, if you think of logic, logic very, very definitely surrounds truth, doesn't it? And emotion, if you look at the most dominant emotion you can feel that's the most pleasurable, it's generally always love, right? So you can see again truth and love being needed, right, in any interaction and also in any investigation. Now, for the female, you are going to have to completely open up to emotion before you're going to be able to completely determine truth. For a male, he's going to have to completely open up to logic before he's going to be able to start to determining truth. Does that make sense? Right. Does everyone get that? So when a male says to me, we're driving down the road and I say, oh, that house wasn't built by anybody, and that house wasn't built by anybody, and so forth, which is totally illogical. And he says, you're being totally logical now. I go, yes, I am. Right? And then I say, well, your body was built by somebody too. And then now he says, no, that's not true. And I say, now you're being totally illogical. If he connects to the reason why he's being illogical, he'll actually work through the situation quite well and be able to determine some truth. But that kind of discussion generally won't interest the woman as much, right? And that's because the way in which she associates truth is through the emotion of love, right? And both halves of this are a part of the halves of the soul. Remember, our soul is one complete unit expressed in a masculine and feminine form. So we need both halves. The difference for myself, though, with yourself, darling, is that I am not blocked to my emotion.
And I see that. I see that you are quite open to both logic and emotion.
Yep.
Absolutely.
And I don't have a fear or a terror. It goes off again. I don't have a fear or terror associated with the emotion. Yeah? Yeah. If we just turn on, if you turn them back on, Alex, and then just turn off two of the back ones or something. On the left-hand side, there's four switches. Now, if you go across, no further, off the box. Yeah. The right-hand side ones are the ones I was going to point you to. If you turn on the left-hand side ones and turn off the right-hand side ones, that'll give us light at the front where we can still use our video, and hopefully it might stop tripping the lights.
Thank you, darling. And I apologise to everyone else if that wasn't relevant. But
I think it is a relevant part of the discussion in the sense that God has given us two ways to examine everything. And one way is dominantly masculine and the other way is dominantly feminine.
Yeah, and I guess I'm having stronger and stronger feelings about that, yeah.
Yeah. And if we can include both methods, if a person of any gender includes both methods, you will arrive at certainty. Yeah. And if you examine, it's the same with the wind. If we go back to the wind analogy, and I used to use the wind analogy all the time in the first century, And if you go back to that analogy, you can see the effects of the wind, there's the logic. You can feel the effects of the wind, there's the emotion, there's the feelings. And if you examine God in the same way, you'll be able to both see God through logic and see God through feelings. Alex?
Now, that's really awesome that you brought that up, Mary, because I've been kind of trying to work this out for a while. And in my relationship with my partner, the same sort of thing happens where I have a tendency to see things as a way of patterns. I look back and through experience, I say, when this happened last time, this was happening.
Yeah.
So there's a pretty likely event that the same thing is happening again.
Yes.
So if we can start from there, and this is the way I talk to her to try and help her.
So you face things through a logical perspective. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So then I guess I try and make her see in that way to...
So you present her with some logic that she can then work her way through.
Yeah.
Yep.
But I feel this... maybe this is a frustration in me that I don't feel that she can feel that or she does that same sort of thing.
Yep.
She approaches it from a totally different point.
She will. She'll be approaching it from this direction.
Yeah, yeah.
The exactly. other half of the soul is the way that it approaches. Yeah. So this is where each half of the soul can assist the other. So for example, the feminine half of the soul can assist the male to feel about things when he's trying to think about them all the time, right? So for example, if you analyse things from a purely loving perspective, you can see a lot of truth automatically. Yeah, and you can see it often a lot more rapidly than you can if you examine it from a logical perspective, right? The truth is that if you make the presumption that love and truth are associated with each other, you can actually see a lot of truth by actually examining what's loving and what isn't loving, right? And this is where... But to do that, you have to be open emotionally. You have to be open to feelings and sensations, right? And this is where I feel there's been a dominant shutdown of femininity on the planet. Feelings and sensations and emotions have been... Women have been told now for many, many centuries that they're having an emotion and they're having a feeling or a sensation is not very trustworthy. They've been told that it's actually lesser in terms of priority than logic itself. This is why many women are trying to become more logical without and trying to feel less, right, on the planet. The problem with doing that is you will find you're shutting down the ability God's given you to determine truth, right? So when you're criticized for being emotional, or when you're criticized for being sensitive or feeling things, but usually, oftentimes, the criticism comes from a male, yes? They are not realizing at that time that they're actually shutting down the way in which a woman determines truth and the way in which she has a natural ability to determine truth. When a woman criticizes a man's logic, which I see many women also doing, she is not realizing in that moment that she is shutting down him from determining truth through the determination of logic, because that is the way that he is connected to the determination of truth. Right? If instead we learn to embrace the other way rather than criticize it, so the man learns to embrace the feminine way and the female learns to embrace the masculine way, then in the end we'll have even more power to determine truth. But what we have happening on the planet is a separation between the two methods. The masculine condemns the feminine for their emotion, and the feminine condemns the masculine for his logic. That's very counterproductive. Because when you look at how we need to see God, we can see one aspect is very logical and one aspect is very emotional or feeling-based. And to be frank, we need to engage both if we're really going to determine the truth. Can you see that? And so my suggestion is stop condemning the opposite gender for what appears to be their inability to be like you, right? Because the reality is that we are both able, both sides of the genders are able to use both methods to determine truth and need to. And we need to honour in the other what is not in ourselves rather than condemning in the other what is not in ourselves. Yes? That's what draws you together, actually. Yes? Rather than separating. When the male condemns the female for the lack of logic and the female condemns the male for his lack of emotion, right, we have separation. When the male loves the female for her emotion and the female loves the male for his logic, now we have attraction. And interestingly, I cannot examine my relationship with God without both. Because God is like the wind. God cannot be seen without seeing the effects or feeling them. So therefore, I need both to examine my relationship with God. That makes sense? And
could you have in a same-sex couple, two females, for example, one being more logical than the other and one the other being more emotional, and that's just the exact same situation?
Definitely, although generally in a same-sex couple, in a same-sex soul, there will be a very much more even distribution of logic and emotion, and so therefore both sides of the soul, in the case of yours, both females involved in the complete soul, will have a relatively even distribution of emotion and logic in comparison to other women. And the same applies to a male same gender soul. So when we have a homosexual men couple, there will be a more even distribution of emotion and logic in that couple generally as well.
So the fact that it sometimes looks, say, with a male to male, one is more feminine.
One will always be probably more feminine and one will be more masculine.
In the female-female, one might look really masculine.
Yep.
But then some of those extremes of difference are, my understanding is that's the damage that has come from how society's treated us.
Exactly. Yep. So what I'm saying applies to any soul, whether they're homosexual in nature or heterosexual in nature, which are all just really souls in nature, right? And we just put the labels of homosexuality and heterosexuality upon them. The reality is any soul, which includes you with your other half, includes myself with my other half, any soul has the ability to determine truth through these two ways. And they are the only two ways available to determine truth that is invisible to us. You know, there are certain truths that are visible to us, which we can use our sight, touch, taste, and all other sorts of sensations to determine truth with. But to determine the truth of something that's invisible to us, we only really have two methods. Does that make sense? Available to us. And these two methods are inbuilt inside of each part of the soul. These two methods are inbuilt. But to embrace them, we've got to embrace them. If we're going to embrace logic, then embrace logic completely. Don't be illogical with some things and illogical with others. And if you're going to embrace emotion, be completely emotional. Don't just try to shut it down constantly and push it away constantly and all those kind of things. Embrace the emotion. Many of you ladies are not allowed, or you feel you're not allowed to embrace your emotion. And if you think about relationships you've had in the past or relationships you're in, you can see how often you're not allowing even your own embracing of emotion at times, when you feel very emotional and then you feel a bit self-conscious because the guy sitting next to you watching telly and you're having a cry and he's just looking at it, and you're going, well, what's going on there? And you feel self-conscious and those kind of, these are all emotions that we need to address. We need to come to accept in between the genders that these both methods are essentially part of the way in which we have available to determine truth that is not visible to us. And we need to use both methods if we're ever going to be successful in determining the truth about God. Yeah. Now, perhaps that's the time to just have a break, I think. We'll have a break for an hour, shall we, and just have some lunch and so forth, and then I'm happy to answer any questions about the subject or other subjects after the break. Thanks.